How are you?
Good.
All right, everyone. Welcome back to the interview area for the Women's Open presented by ProMedica. We are joined by 1995, 1996, and 2006 U.S. Women's Open champion Annika Sorenstam, who also won last year's Senior Women's Open to earn her place in the field. Annika, just how does it feel to be back at a U.S. Women's Open?
Oh, it feels awesome. It's great to be here, of course. Mike and I, we were here for the media day not too long ago, but still we didn't play the golf course then, didn't get a chance to go out on the golf course, but did today, arrived yesterday with the family, and it's just such a nice vibe around here. Just love this area, and renting a house just around the corner, walking around, seeing all the players, seeing a lot of Annika alumni, and it's great to be here.
I know you did a little walk and talk with us on 18 a couple weeks back, but what are the memories you have from that week, the win in 96?
Yeah, there's certain memories I have. I mean, I have, walking down 18. It's just such a special hole. It's iconic, kind of the finish. And, Peggy was here then, Peggy Kirkbell, and she screamed, Heineken when I can finish, which is, we've talked about that story here, not knowing my name or remembering or be able to say my name, so I became Heineken. But it was a great week. I mean, it was just, I came in as a defending champion. I really didn't know what to expect and just played really, really well. And I was in the zone that week. And so I wish, it's great to be in the zone, but then I don't really remember. I was in a different zone. So now it's like, okay, what was I really thinking? So I have to kind of create that again. But, walking the fairways today with Mike, and it's really nice to be here.
What does your preparation look like for this week? Lydia Ko was here earlier. She said she sees you out there a lot more at Lake Nona now.
I know. I can't hide. I can't hide. And I've seen her, too. Let's put it that way. I've seen a few of them out there. Leona's been there. And I have been practicing. My coach Henry came to town last week and just want to fine tune it a little bit. I know, to play well here, I gotta really max out my game. So he came. Haven't seen him in a long time, so that was good. And I've been trying. I really have the last month or so as much as I can with the schedule that I have with the kids. The kids finish school now. There's summer and lots of activities and some other things I do with the foundation. So, I've been trying to squeeze in as much as I can. I'm trying to find a balance of working on my swing and then also playing. I mean, it's one thing, as I keep telling the girls that I work with, you practice golf and then you play golf. So for me, I have to, transition from practicing to really playing, hitting one shot and scoring. So I've been doing that, quite a bit as well.
Right here to Beth Ann.
Yeah, I know that you're here for your family and for all the girls who've played in all your tournaments and a source of inspiration, but the competitor in you, I'm sure, has some expectations. What are those? What would you consider to be a great week here?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. My goal is obviously to play the best I can. I know what I'm capable of. I can hit fairways, I can hit greens, I can make putts. So, that's my goal this week. Obviously I'm a different position now than in 96 where, I was probably one of the longest off the tees and would hit last into the greens. Now it's a reverse. So kind of the feeling that I had when I played at the Colonial, just get out there, hit first on the greens. But, I think this course is quite generous off the tee, and it's more around the greens, being precise with your irons. So, I'm not really going to have a score in mind, but I feel good about my game. I really do. I mean, this is if you think about the time I've put in and the time that I have, I'm there where I can be. And we'll just see where that takes me. This is really everything I have, and we're going to make the most out of it. We're excited to be here. We're going to enjoy it. We're going to hit some shots and just soak up the atmosphere. I want the kids to see what it's like to play in an open, and I've been here. And so it's more to maximize on a lot of different levels than just my game.
Jonathan?
What's it like? You mentioned it, seeing that there's graduates of your camps, your clinics, your tournaments out here. There's a lot of younger players, 22 players are under the age of 19, under the age of 20. What is that like? Seeing the future of the future of golf out here right before you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that says it right there. We have 68 of, Annika alumnus, and I like to say we're 69 if I count. I'm not young, but I go to every event that we play, so I really should count. I think that says a lot about women's golf. I think, we spend a lot of time with the foundation of girls between 12 and 18. So I'm not surprised, because we see that level of golf at an early age than we have ever had. So nice to see them here. The future is strong, and hopefully that will inspire other young girls to continue to play or pick up the game.
you said in the past that your kids have only seen you play some of your tournaments on YouTube.
Yeah.
What's this like week going to be like to see them play, let them see you play out here in person?
Yeah, it'd be nice. I mean, now they've seen me a few more times. So, yeah, you should ask them what they think. But obviously, you know, it's nice to have them out here. They know what has taken, you know, the time I put in. Will has been with me a lot of the times. Ava's been very supportive. And of course, Mike, who does a lot. I mean, he wears as many hats as I do. Daddy hat, business hat, and then obviously caddy hat this week. So it's a team effort. We've said that all along. And we'll see. I mean, Will just gave me a good advice coming here. He says, I love you so much, Mommy. I believe in you. So I think that's what I'm going to keep the rest of the week.
Sarah?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned it earlier, your relationship with Peggy Kirk-Bell. I mean, obviously, I think everybody kind of knew maybe that you were going to come back this week, but was that kind of a driving force to come back here to Pine Creek?
Yeah, absolutely. I would, you know, there's a few factors. You know, winning, obviously getting the exemption is number one. Coming here with Peggy is, you know, maybe two, my family, I mean, three, and then my family's probably two, wanting me to be part of this again. And you know, with the girls that have played in our tournaments, just to inspire them and continue to inspire golfers around the world. So I think there's four or five factors, and you know, it certainly would have been different if this was somewhere else. But you know, I have a nice you know, friendship with her family too, you know, her kids and grandkids, and just kind of being here and coming back. So that means the world to me.
As you've walked around this property today, besides obviously the Heineken the Heineken thing, have there been any other kind of flashes of memories that you've gotten from that win in 96 and all the time you've spent
there? I think, I mean, one of the things, it's flashing memories, but I don't see it. I mean, Peggy would always come out in the golf cart, and we would hit balls at the back of the range. When we played her in 96, we hit from this side of the range. You know, we're behind the putting green there, and we hit that direction. If you want a little privacy, you went to the other side, and you can hit and grind a little bit more. And then she would come up in a golf cart and just kind of park it there and watch, not say too much, but then she would say something, and then she would leave. And then I would always meet her up here in the clubhouse, and, you know, she showed me her office a few times and just kind of listened to her stories. She was a great storyteller. I wish I could remember more stories. I have a lot of stories throughout my career, but she was just a great, you know, great person and fun to be around. She had humor, and she was just, you know, she was tough. I don't know. I mean, she flew her own plane. I mean, who would fly his own plane today? Just play a tournament and go out and let's go next destination. I mean, she was a trailblazer and a cool lady in so many ways.
Andrew?
Annika, Michelle Wee is stepping away from the game after this week. Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask you, when she first came out on tour, what sort of a career did you think she'd have?
Oh, I mean, she's had a great career to start with. I think, you know, I played with her quite a few times when she was, 13, 14, maybe 15. I played with her in the last group at, the Chevron Championship. It was Dinah Shore at the time. I played with her in the last group. To have an amateur, to have a teenager at that time, that was really impressive. She hit the ball a long ways. I mean, I remember her swing was just, I mean, it was really very powerful, especially her wedge game. She just put a lot of spin on the ball, and you know, being 6 foot, something like that, I mean, I was like, wow, this girl got it. So, and like I said, she still had a great career in many ways, but I, you know, maybe other people thought she would do more, but it's hard to win out here. She won a U.S. Open, as you know, in other events, so she's been great for the game.
Do you think injuries maybe had a role to play, or is there more to do with it?
Yeah, I really don't know. I mean, she has a lot of great things going for her, being a mother and a wife and all the other businesses. I think, you know, there's a lot on the plate, and which I can kind of relate to. I know what it's like with other interests. So, you know, it's a fun time for her.
Right here in the red.
Annika, one of the volunteers told me that you went out to the maintenance shed last night after playing and hung out with some of the workers over there. What was that like? How did that come about?
Well, first of all, I mean, it's, as you know, there's a big women crew this week. They brought in women, I wouldn't say superintendents, but crew workers from different parts of the country. And I think that's really a cool initiative to have women part of that. And the lady that's kind of spearheading it, she works out of Minnesota with the course that I, one of the nearby courses that I designed with Anna Palmer. So I would see her out there. She's done a few things for the foundation. So she contacted Mike, and I just thought it was a great, you know, neat thing for the women to be here. I mean, it's kind of, when we look at the golf industry, there are a few things where you don't see a lot of women. That's in design and in the maintenance, and to have a lot of women there, and it was just neat thing to see and say thank you.
Kent?
Annika, you've remained a resonant force in the game of golf. What lessons can the LPGA and its players take away from how you've built your brand up as they look to promote its next stars?
Wow, that's a big question. I mean, I think the LPGA does a really good job. I mean, they have, I think they've done an amazing job together with this USGA just to look at this tournament. And I think maybe I've learned some things from them, you know, how to build a brand and being consistent what you do and what you deliver. So I feel very fortunate to have the game of golf as kind of my vehicle, my platform to be able to share the passion I have, whether it's through the foundation or my partners. So I think it's a partnership that go back, you know, hand in hand. I mean, especially when you think of the Rolex Annika Major Award, it's one of my main partners, LPGA, and then we're here at the U.S. Open. So I never really thought I would play to get some points, so I'm trying to get some Rama points.
You've played in all four U.S. Opens here. How can you compare and contrast the course 96, 01, 07, and then now, especially post-restoration?
Yeah, you know, it's longer. I don't remember number one teeing off so close to 18 green and back here almost by the 18th green there. I mean, it's longer for me. I don't know what the yardage was. I'd be curious to know what it played in 96. But it's roughly 67 today. So I'm hitting longer clubs into the greens. But most of all, I mean, it's the green areas. You know, there's a lot of runouts. There's a lot of, you know, undulation to the greens, knowing the course. I mean, at that time, I think I knew a lot of it. But I also hit it where I wanted it. I think that's the key, is hitting it where you plan to hit it. Today, I'm standing there, with, like I said, with hybrids, so maybe 5-iron or maybe in the 6 or 7. So you have to be a little bit more precise. So I think as far as an approach, I'm going to be aggressive with what I have, but then conservative, just hitting greens. You know, I'm not in a spot right now in my career where I can attack these hole locations. I don't be foolish if I did. So I have to be a little smarter than I was then. But I love the rest of what they've done to the course, especially number 10, the way they kind of put some bunkers in front. I remember going for the green in 2 there, but not today. And probably won't do all week, but it's okay. It's fun to, I mean, I think that's a good golf course, is you can play it many different ways, and I'll play it differently this year than I did then.
Mm-hmm. A couple more, Ron.
When you won here, the total purse was $1.2 million. Mm-hmm. This year, the winner is going to get $1.8 million. Yes. What's that say about the growth of the women's
game? I think it's fantastic. I think it's great. I think it's thank you, USGA, for doing that, for kind of stepping up and giving the women that opportunity. I mean, that is a massive change. I think it's a massive boost. I think it gives the women a lot more credibility and respect for doing that. You know, I really don't come here for that reason, but I think it's nice to see the women really, that this is really paying off. So keep on going. Hope other tournaments will follow suit. And let's keep working this direction for all the women.
Beth Ann, on your right.
Yeah, I was just curious how your preparation for this week compared to the run-up to the Senior Women's Open. Did you do anything different?
Well, this time, I mean, I played from... I think Lydia saw that. I played from the blue tees at home. I've been playing from similar distance. You know, when I played for the senior, I move up a little bit. But I knew that this is what I had to do. I mean, I have to do that. I've been working on some bump and runs more with the hybrid. We played NCR a few weeks ago, and I don't see that shot being as handy as here. So I think you have to adjust a little bit. But, you know, really right now, I mean, the focus is if I can just, you know, hit fairways and greens and just kind of stay sharp. You know, I was out there on the – which hole was it? I played with Megan Kang today. We were on 15, and I hit a shot, and it felt good. But I turned to Mike. I said, you know, my body's starting to stiff up. And I kind of whispered that to him. And then Megan hit a shot, and she goes – and she ripped it, and she goes, finally, I'm getting loose. And I'm like, that's the- And I said, I just told Mike I'm stiffening up and you're getting loose. So here we go.
If I could just ask one more. Michelle said earlier today that a player came up to her in player dining and said that she was named after her.
Oh, after that's Michelle nice.
I'm wondering how often you've heard that over the years.
Yeah, no, it's been a few times. I know, you know, the Becoming Annika, they had that on one of the slides, or not slides, but it was showing, and I know names. So there's actually a young lady walking here today. Her name is Annika, and she was born in 1996. So I thought that was pretty cool. So, yeah, it's been, I mean, what a great honor that is to name your child after you. That's pretty special.
Last question will go to an Annika alum.
There we go, yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to ask, during your preparation when you haven't had as much time to practice as you used to do when you were playing on tour with your other duties, what have been the main things that you focused on when you kind of have a restricted amount of time to practice and prepare?
That's a good question. I mean, that's the thing. You need to make it more quality than quantity. I mean, I only have so much, so now it's, you know, taking time to do the most of it. So for me, it's a lot of, first it was more specific technique, okay, focus on technique. And then I figured out the technique is more tempo and finding the rhythm. And then number three is scoring. So I kind of have like a sequence that I do it. Before, I could kind of mix and mingle the way it was. I could be on the course, I can work on my technique. But now it's like, okay, I only have so much time. So, you know, I don't have as much time to work on specialty shots, and which is probably what you need around here, but I've spent a lot of time working on my chipping. Will loves to chip, and we have a lot of chipping competition in Orlando, and he only chips with a 60 degree, so do I, and I'm coming here, I'm like, wow, this is really working. So thanks to that, I feel like my chipping is probably as good as it's ever been. So you never know where your skills are going to tune up because of different reasons.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Good luck, Annika.
Thank you, everybody.